The month of fear is upon us, so let us review a ghostly entity this month at least once. This one is quite mysterious, as his origin is only theorized, not cemented in canon. He could be a man who hated Christ after his child was killed during the massacre of the innocents, and was punished for flagellating him by staying in the world until his resurrection. He could be a man who killed himself after an angel saved him, but the angel forbade his entry to the afterlife and reanimated him without his memories and had to keep man from becoming evil, one soul at a time. He may even be a fallen angel forced to walk the earth forever for not siding with either heaven or hell during the rebellion of Lucifer. Or he could be lame and possibly a scientist caught in a time loop when trying to prevent an avatar of anti-life from destroying the universe through weird science of moving energy from the Big Bang to extend the life of the universe. I wish he would have stayed silent. That's just not fun, though. Besides, I didn't expect you to want to review something. You seemed content just being stuck in this void. Me partaking in reviews is your fault. That part of your soul is still intact, and I can't shake it off me. So, until I can figure it out, I will let it be. I knew my clinginess would be good for something someday. Let's stop wasting time, though, and take a look into this rather supernatural and unknown person. This is a review of DC Showcase 4, The Phantom Stranger. We open up out on a desert to California with some hitchhiker girl moving to probably some hippie commune, given that they talk about suburban prisons or seeing the truth of the system, though one does give an ominous comment about how the man they are meeting, Seth, knows all about souls. The Phantom Stranger walks on screen in the most ordinary way possible and talks to the viewers, apparently.
It is said, not all those who wander are lost. But many are. And once lost, they may truly be lost forever.
Interesting. I guess Travelocity was right then in that we should always
wander wisely.
A nice but shallow sentiment, honestly, that comes off like he is trying too hard to be philosophical. Catching up with the hippies, they arrive at Seth's place, which is a nice villa with a statue of a devil, or perhaps the Greek god Pan. It does look rather creepy, and our main girl stays outside to smoke a bit and calm her nerves. As she looks in the fountain, a dead fish comes up, and the Phantom Stranger continues his poetic thoughts, who she assumes is Seth. He asks why her friends follow Seth, and she talks about looking for a truth about something the previous generation didn't care for. He reveals himself as the Phantom Stranger, and he tries to warn her not to go in, but she flips out for some reason. Those darn millennials hating old men trying to help them out and being hostile almost immediately. In actuality, she's just being a dumb, rebellious young adult, and lashing out because this guy can't understand her, so he shouldn't act like he does. When she turns around to tell him to leave, he is already gone and her nerves are not calm at all.
Weirdo.
Wow, those smokes must really be getting to her. She gets taken inside and they start drinking, and as they talk about the previous owner, one Jonathan Lord, who is another DC hero but with the power to become any character he has performed on the silver screen, and oh my gosh! Is that Paul Stanley? No, we finally are introduced to Seth, who almost instantly entrances our girl, Marcy. Then he starts to read her like he knows her, but this doesn't piss her off, probably because of magic. Also, he has a lot of cult paraphernalia just lying around, and they start partying with the worst dance moves and kind of janky animation. Though Seth puts what I believe is wine or blood on these people's foreheads, like some cult initiation, all while he smiles. He then kisses one of the women to death, as well as the others as candles are burnt out, but Marcy is all that remains. As she goes in to kiss him, the Phantom Stranger appears and forces her away.
You won't have her, Seth. You've feasted enough on these children.
They come willingly. They do my work for me.
Not this one.
I'm fine with you killing maybe thousands of others, but not her. Seth and him act like they have history, which, given how old both are, they probably do, and begin to have a good old-fashioned clash of steel. Seth claims to be unbeatable because of his
Ouroboros pendant.
It's Ouroboros, not Ouroboros. But yes, his Ouroboros pendant would make him immortal so long as he absorbs the life of people. But they continue fighting, though Seth's power apparently is weaker. With one quick grab, Phantom Stranger bests him, but Marcy conks him with a vase to knock him out. Seth has him tied up and starts to drain him of his life, while Phantom Stranger tells her to run away. And only when Seth starts acting eviler by shutting him up, she discovers the others are dead, and she's turned on by him? What? As creepy as that would be, she had a change of heart and breaks the Ouroboros pendant with ease under her heel, instantly aging him thousands of years and turning to dust. Phantom Stranger broke free and asks what she'll be doing now, and she replies she's gonna keep searching for her own truth, and steals the car for herself, and that brings an end to our ghostly tale. What a thing that was. Yes, it definitely was not the best work, but it also wasn't bad. It was a little enjoyable, but it was also kind of bland. For our titular character, the Phantom Stranger was meh. I do not care for his philosophical musings, and him choosing to save Marcy over the others is rather conflicting for me, because if I am supposed to like him, him letting four or five other people die is not a great look, though I can only assume he didn't save them because they were too far gone in his eyes. It's just a weird sense of favoritism for this soul who has yet to be corrupted while condemning those who fell. Seth is okay as a villain. It's a pretty generic plan for any deity that seeks to extend their life, so nothing special. The fight between him and the Phantom Stranger is alright as well. The flow stops and starts, but it does look a bit nice. The music, though, I think really works well during the partying scene, as I do think it does play into the sinister nature of Seth, with the music coming to its height when the people are being killed, while also keeping them in an ignorant state. And when he's one-on-one with Marcy, it becomes a bit romantic, but reaches a height once more when Marcy tries to kiss him and when the stranger appears. The music itself isn't spectacular, but it's okay. I hate that the only descriptions we have for it are on the level of average, but that is the best way to describe it too. From the story, to the characters, to the animation at certain points, to even the music, which is something we usually overlook, all of it is average. There's nothing to make me want to come back to this and rewatch it. Upon watching it once, you essentially get everything there is to know, aside from the reference to Jonathan Lord, and the implication that he was killed by Seth. But that's not very intriguing. I know Kat also doesn't like that the Phantom Stranger needed the help of the girl to break free since it seems like he is nerfed, but I'm not bothered by it. It is very much a test of character for her, since he does want to save her soul, and I'm not entirely sure he needed the help, but rather wanted to see what she'd do. After all, once she finds the bodies and Seth sees her, the sound and visual effects of Seth's powers stop, so the Phantom Stranger probably was already free from it. To rate it, it's a solid 5 out of 10. It doesn't really have anything good or bad. Am I glad to have watched it? Not really. I don't regret it, though. Would I recommend it? No. Would I watch it again? No. Did I even like it? Eh? What a terrible way to start our reviews for this month. I feel we have to do something to make up for it, otherwise I'll have wasted my time with you, Wolf. Yeah, I ain't letting this average schlock be the only thing we review. Until next time, we're Wolf, and we'll see you all later. Bye-bye!